Lucchetti. She's back with us. And we're obviously very excited. This is a pretty exciting night for a lot of people, I must say. Okay. So if you weren't here the first time, we're going to go through your sweet little bio here. So, Anne Lucchetti, she is an executive at the Leith Group. Her 20 years of experience in university teaching, most recently at Texas Christian University and North Carolina State University. She's done consulting, training seminars, covers such topics as conflict resolution, group and team dynamics, leadership, interviewing, interpersonal communication skills. Anne received her doctorate from the University of Texas at Austin with a research emphasis in interpersonal and organizational communication, her master's degree from Purdue University and a psychology degree from Albion College. And she also works with the engaged couples here doing conflict resolution at St. Thomas Aquinas. So once again, we're happy to have her back, and we're going to go ahead and get started because we got a lot to cover.
Yeah, we got a lot to cover.
We got a lot to cover.
Awesome.
All right, you guys.
Now that you know that you've graduated high school, you like to travel, I want you to do something bold. How many people have a list of what their potential spouse should be like? Does anybody have a list? All right. Okay. I am not an advocate necessarily of a list. Back in my day, so remember dating a really long time ago, Cosmo was not as raunchy as it is today. But they would do those polls, so this, select this, select that. So I remember doing that, ripping it out, putting it in my drawer, and then I met my husband John, and I was moving, and I pulled it out and ran into the list. And believe it or not, he was my list. So it's, again, I'm not necessarily a fan of it, but it's an interesting exercise. And so I thought we should do that as a group. So I want you in your small group to come up with what the top three most important qualities your potential spouse should have. And we're going to make a list of them. So let's take a few minutes. Let's take till 7:40 and come up with the three as a group. So what do you all think?
Okay. of things we were like, yeah, that's a good thing too. So,
what's an and to hear? You guys have an and? What's your and?
We have love God above me.
Okay.
Joyful.
Oh.
Challenges you / brings out your best.
Ooh. So if these were our Scholastic list, this is our Harvard MBA list. I really like that. Challenges you, brings out your best. Okay, so what else is on this list that we're not missing? I think we talked about loyalty over here. And I want to give you another thing, you guys.
Communication.
Yeah?
Communication.
You know, that's my deal, so I love communication.
Forgiving.
Oh, I think you read my notes. So we talked last week, or the last time I was here, about radical authenticity. Okay, intelligent. What are we missing?
Sense of humor.
I like it. As a basis for talking about when you're looking for someone. So if you remember passion, that's sort of the chemistry, the attraction, the zing. That's one part of our relationship triangle for consummate love. we have intimacy or friendship. So this is specialness, uniqueness, secret sharing. When you're in a relationship with someone, your relationship should be different than any other relationship you have with anyone else, because they know certain things about you. You are special to each other. What I like to say about marriage, we know about men's friendship, that men don't have a wide number of friendship. That may be different for a group like this, where you still are really connecting and making good friendships. But once you get married and go down that path and have kids, men's friendships shrink. And they end up having friends that they've had for 20 years. So they stay with those friends that have been their best friends since elementary school often. Whereas women have a wider range, but a little bit more superficial. So one of the benefits of marriage is the husband's wife is his best friend. She's the only one he tells secrets to. He's the only one he's that vulnerable and intimate with. And that is such a beautiful thing, but when we see marriages struggle is where they forget that intimacy. So it's not natural for a guy to want to be vulnerable. It's just uncomfortable. And yet that's really the glue that keeps her heart open for him. So one of the things I'd have a couple, if they came to see me, I'd give them homework about make sure every day you share something about how you feel and emotion, because those are the things you don't share with anyone else. We're not sharing emotions. So friendship, specialness, those are important. And then commitment. This is trust, stability, loyalty. So all three of those go together for what we call consummate love, or what you're looking for. This is what your relationship should look like as you are walking down the aisle. All three of those parts are super important. Okay, so what's interesting is you'll see couples who don't have all three balanced. So one of the things I see is companionate love. It's not wrong to be in a romantic relationship with your best friend. But I think God has a plan for us that has passion involved too. Attraction, that special quality that when you look at each other, you think, man, you're so cute. And it doesn't have to be objectively cute. This is an interesting thing about physical attractiveness and who we end up partnering with. So you know the scale, 1 to 10 kind of thing. People marry within 2 degrees of that scale. So if you're a 7, you marry an 8, a 7, or a 6, 6, 7, 8. Because otherwise, and you know if you've dated someone who's a 10 and you're a 7, 6, you date a 10. The imbalance that you feel in dating above your rank, so to speak, causes insecurity. And it makes you more anxious than you should be, because you're thinking, man, if I think he's a 10, and everybody else thinks he's a 10, and what's he doing with me? So that's not how our plan is meant to be. And then the other way, if you think you're better looking than your partner, again, this is all your own perception, it causes an imbalance that way. Like, wow, oh, I could do better. So not God's plan, I don't believe for us. But let's not diminish passion as an important part of our relationships. Have you ever seen like an 80-year-old couple who still like they hold hands and kiss? Like it's the cutest fucking thing. And that's what we wish for you, is that that passion is still alive. You know it's going to change and mold. That's our plan. But if it's not there, I worry, because you have a lot of friends who you are committed to them, you are loyal, you are there for them in times of need. So companionate love is an important relationship in our lives. But I don't think it's the hallmark of where we should be romantically. But do we oftentimes let lust drive us into relationships that aren't good for us? For sure. And so we have a strange relationship with the passion part. Because we don't, in our secular world, which is sex all the time, sex for fun, casual sex, all that, all the music we listen to, all the TV, all the movies. It's a difficult way to understand what our real role is in attraction. And I think Brandon will talk about that next week when we talk about chastity, right? Yeah, so you're supposed to struggle with that. Because if you're not, then maybe your relationship is too companionate. Okay, here's some questions for our group again. So we're going to break for it and do these questions. Do you guys believe in love at first sight? Why or why not? Are you able to identify the one even if your triangle isn't completely balanced? And the last ones, what are ways that you can strengthen that triangle so you find yourself in a relationship that is really passion-filled, but maybe the intimacy level isn't there or the commitment level isn't there? How do we strengthen those? So let's take about 5 minutes and talk about that. We'll come back together at 8. Where you realize you've been stuck in one of the dimensions of the triangle for too long, it's hard to almost jump start it into the other one. So if you've been friends with someone for a long time, it's hard to move it into the passion realm. Or sadly, it's been in the passion realm for too long, but you're not really friends. So that's a difficult transition.
Will in terms of can you actually make a commitment.
that part. I really do love that part. If we are not free, we are not all in. If we can't commit, because we're dating other people, or that if we don't have that free, then we're trying to for sure can't commit. All right, how can you strengthen those dimensions? So what are the ways that you strengthen intimacy? I think we heard over here, spending the time communicating, spending time being vulnerable. How do you increase commitment? That one really is time spent. Yeah. That's it, including the other person, choosing them, prioritizing them. That's the specialness.
By making it official, because too often I've seen people that just kind of we're in talking phase, and then you never really get out of the talking phase.
You know DTR, right? You know that. Ages ago. So my area is, you know, relationship communication. Define a relationship was a coined term in the relationship research, so DTR. But now it's like layperson terms. Like, that's a turning point. Your first big fight is one, too. It's a turning point. But the define the relationship talk is definitely an important one. And you're right. The define the relationship talk is your commitment talk. What are we to each other? Are we exclusive? And all that. All right, so the hardest question is, how do you strengthen passion?
Well, we talk about fertility awareness, and sometimes people think that like that's the last like passionate thing, but it really is, because you talk about sex more often than most people who are having sex continuously. And you also deal with it, and you actually communicate it in a totally different manner, so it's not it's not like uncomfortable. It's like, this is something that we're dealing with, this is supposed to be what
and chemically, yeah. We are attracted to each other at different times of our cycle and all that. So I do talk to couples about natural family planning is an intimate way to communicate. So I didn't know how important it was until I started working with couples about having both partners involved with what's going on. With fertility, it's a really cool, intimate thing where you're knowing everything about each other. It's the basis to me for transparency in a marriage. And so we'll meet a lot of couples who'll say, "No, that's such garbage. I'm not doing that." Secular teachings and all that. And yet, when I hear them talk, I hear them not being open to what kind of God intended for all of us. And then I worry, well, what other parts of you are closed off from your spouse? So, interesting. So, I want to say about passion, what's interesting about passion, we are physically attracted to competence. So how you increase attraction thing is by showing off what you're good at. Showing off your passion. Isn't that cool? So, let's say you're an excellent karaoke singer. Well, you better get out of the karaoke bar. So remember that, because as I was talking to someone today about, you know, what is attraction, and, you know, we have our sort of set understanding of who our type is, and you know, by the time your hair is gray and you have 50 more pounds than you should, one of the ways when you look at your spouse and you still find them attractive has a lot to do with competence, with what a good thinker they are, how they push you intellectually, how they consider problems differently than you, how they are so good with your children, how they're good with their job, their career, whatever. You look at each other and you still find attraction. Not necessarily, they're not, you know, on the cover of People magazine as the world's most beautiful people, but they are so beautiful to you because competence is super attractive. And so that's why we're all called to live our vocation, whatever our vocation is in terms of career and occupation, to the best of our ability. Because in doing that, you are so attractive. Okay, so here goes. Let's go. This is the meat of our talk. Which personal qualities are related to marital success? So when you come and you are engaged at St. Thomas, we have you do a number of questionnaires, surveys that you fill out. And then your priest or your deacon, sometimes you get to talk to me, goes through your scores as a couple. One of the ones that I found, and I teach the conflict, the constructive conflict communication class for the engaged couples, one of the things I found is this first one, and we heard it, it's on our board actually. It's called forgivingness. It's a weird term, I don't actually think that's a word. But the idea, what behind it, what it means is that the person that you are dating has a maturity about the disappointments they've had in their lives. That when you talk to them, they have processed it, worked through it in a way that really you understand the pain that they've gone through, but you've also understood the work that they've done. Also, as you're talking to your partner about a bad day at work or a frustration or a missed expectation in their current lives, how do they process that? Are they able to see that there are two parties in any missed expectation, in any conflict? If they have conflict with their coworkers, it's not just a one-sided deal. I find that this comes up as very important later on in marriage. Because as I say on your wedding day, you are marrying potential. You have no idea what the road ahead, what God has planned for you, but if you know that if I screw up, my partner will handle that with forgiveness. There is such a trust that you can have. That's a beautiful quality, but it's a weird one. I have a survey for it if you want to know what your forgiveness score is. I got that. I'll share it with you. All right, flexibility. This is a willingness to accept influence. This is super important for you guys as men. To be willing to accept influence from your girlfriend, spouse, wife, however this works. That you are not so stubborn. That you don't occasionally let her take the lead. So John Gottman, one of my favorite researchers, he does the best relationship research I know, talks about influence in a marriage. Both parties have to have it. It doesn't have to happen all the time, because we know that there is an imbalance oftentimes in who takes the lead. But again, because I study conflict, the addresser, quick decision maker addresser, is usually the one who's on the forefront of making decisions and taking the lead. In my marriage, that's my husband. I am the peacekeeper, pleaser, recovering conflict avoider. And so it's just easier, more comfortable, it is our balance, that he makes most of the decisions, takes the lead. That's how we've worked it out. But I have to know, if something is important to me, if I'm going to dig my heels in, that he'll give. And that's very important. Because we get cemented, as marriage goes on, we get cemented in our patterns. And if one party feels that they have no option to influence, then you start hiding stuff. You start being deceptive. And you're even deceptive to yourself. Warning you. Conflict avoiders, that oftentimes we will go outside our marriage to get our needs met because we don't know sometimes how to say it. And so we have to be super careful, and for sure I have to be on my guard that I am saying what I need to say. That's why I call myself a recovering conflict avoider, because I have to say what I need to say and that I can't bury it. But it's hard, and we have a number of ways that that works in our marriage, because he knows that I have that tendency. I'll say yes to everything. Do you want to go to Maggiano's for dinner? Yep. And then I think, no, there's too many carbs. What am I going to eat there? I don't really want to go. And then I have a bad night. I'm in a bad mood when we're out to dinner, spending money on a date night, and I'm crabby. And it's all because I said yes instead of speaking my needs. So we have a one-off. So he gives me 5 minutes, and he comes back. Annie, Maggiano's? And I am brave enough at that point, because I had 5 minutes to think about it, to come back and be like, no, how about Mexican? Okay, so. All right, self-awareness. You guys did some excellent work last week. Excellent work. if you, I just looked at the slides. If you had, if you weren't here for your emotional baggage, please look that up, because self-awareness is one of our expectations coming into marriage. I want our couples to know that they are marrying a grown-up. No passive aggressiveness. That is not allowed. If you are passive aggressive, you learned it well. Your parents taught it to you. If you learned it, you got it. It's your history. Now stop it. Because your partner has to know they are marrying an adult. That is, the gift you give them is self-awareness. So the way I see it plays out is, do you understand when you are disquieted? Do you understand when your stomach is roiling? Do you take the time to figure out what it is in your circumstance that's upsetting you? You have to be on that journey of knowing what your triggers are. Because if you know them, you can talk about them, you and your partner can work through them. But if you just come with a whole ball of upset, you blame other people. You blame your partner, you blame circumstances, and we're never going to get anywhere in problem solving if you don't have self-awareness. All right, here's my favorite two. These are the hallmark of any quality marital relationship. And we heard this one over here. Humility. Huge. Huge. Can you say, I'm sorry, I'm wrong? We all don't want to say it. Can you say it? If you can't say it, if your partner can't say it, if you're in a partnership with someone who can't say, oh, I was wrong, then I'm sorry. Be careful. Because humility is huge. Remember how I said, in any conflict, in any missed expectation, there are two of you. So my remedy, when you have gotten into a fight and you're trying to repair it, until you can answer what you did wrong, you have no business coming back in. Because the embers of the conflict are still there. So until you can say, this is on me. I know you did stuff. We'll talk about that. But this is what I did wrong. So super huge. To put yourself at the feet of your partner to say, I'm sorry, is Christ-like. It is our path to walk this way. So humility is huge. So if you're with someone who is narcissistic, who can't see that they do anything wrong, be careful. Next one, second hallmark of marriage, empathy. Are they a good listener? Are they a good detective at what the issue might be? Those are great qualities. There's such a time in your marriage when you need someone to just understand you. Oh my gosh, have you guys seen It's Not About the Nail?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, all right. It's Not About the Nail, very quickly. Men like to fix things. Women like to emote. So I date myself. If I haven't told you white men can't jump, have I shared that with you before? My white men can't jump story, Rosie Perez, Woody Harrelson. She says, I'm thirsty. And he goes to get up and get her a glass of water. And she says, no. I don't want you to solve my problem. I want you to say, I too have felt thirst. I swear on my children's lives that my husband says to me, to felt thirsty. Is that what you mean? Yes, it's a lady. Put the toolbox away. And we need you to say, to felt thirst. And so this empathy thing is understanding where your partner's coming from, seeing it from their perspective, and joining them. Taking a guess. When I say being a good detective, it's taking a guess at what's bothering them. Because any guess is better than no guess. Ah. Oh. Looks like you've had a really hard day. Come here, let me give you a hug. That goes so far. Your partner comes in with a sour look on your face, and you're like, no. And instead, you say, come here, get it. I don't know what's going on. You talk to me, we'll make it better. And a big squeezy hug. It's so amazing. And it's one of the first things we stop doing in marriage, is empathizing. Because we got a
really hard.
Okay. What steps can I take today?
So if you're in my conflict class, you're engaged, and I say, you guys all have homework tonight, and your homework is to go home and pray a prayer of discernment. Lord, if this is not the path that I should be on, remember, they're engaged, right? They are on the wedding train. No one is saying no at this point, but the Catholic Church has a very smart reason for having you have to go through all those hoops, and it's to have discernment. Lord, help me know this is my path, or hit me in the head with a 2x4 and tell me where I'm supposed to go. So that's my first one. Pray for discernment. You today, every day, can have homework, but you pray that you have discernment. So we call our engagement period discernment, a time of discernment. But no one in your family, your friends, will, or people who are vendors who are getting money from you, will stop you. And we like to think we at least make you pause. Story, if I haven't told you this before, I have all these stories, I tell them all the time, so stop me if I've told you this. But okay, I had a couple. They came to my class in December. This is years ago. And she called me on December 20th, 22nd, something like that. I just found something out about my fiance that I didn't know. And we're supposed to go on with my family on vacation. I don't know what I should do. I don't know what we should do either. So how about we pray? Okay, so I said, I'm going to hang up the phone. You hang up the phone. We're going to pray about what you're supposed to do. So we did it. I don't hear from her until January. And she called me and she said, did you pray? And I said, yep. And she said, I did too. And he came in after I got done with my prayer and said, hey, I think we should vacation separately. You go with your family. I'll go with mine. Let's get some time to think. Yeah, and then we'll regroup. So she comes home from her vacation and she goes to get, they share an apartment together, she goes to get her apartment and the locks are changed. That's it. That's how they break it. So be careful about that 2x4 thing, okay? So just say, God works if you ask. And that was her sign that that was not her path, right? That was not who she should go. So I fully believe that God wants to convict us if we allow him to work that way. So I think this is an important prayer. If you haven't, start praying for your future spouse. Because he is out there. And so you pray that they can make the decisions that they need to make to live their lives as fully as they can to get to meet you. Because if you know when you know, they got to be doing their journey too. And they'll know when you show up. And the last one I want to talk about, and you talked about this a little bit, but I talked with this last time I was here, I talked about these. What can you do today to get yourself to be the healthiest person? So when God opens a window and blows your future spouse your way, that you know that you're as healthy as you can be. I like to use, it's a little cheesy, but I like to use, it's something, I'll look at his name, I have it on here. But it's about time management, procrastination kind of thing. But he has these 6 buckets that we should be thinking about in terms of self-mastery. The first one is faith. You guys are doing it, right? You're living your faith life. You're here. I hope you have a fruitful prayer life, where you are bringing what you need to God. This is such an important part of your journey in finding a spouse. Just really diving deep. You guys are doing it. You're living it. I'm so proud of you. It's so vibrant. Brandon was just asking me, you love to do this, don't you? I'm like, yes! There's something so cool about being with you guys. There is an energy in this room that is amazing. So what you're doing is so darn cool. Keep it up. Okay? There's amazing things happening. Family and friends, what are you doing? Because God calls us to communion and connection with others. So what are you doing? Tonight's another example. You're here. You're in community. You're with friends. How balanced is that? Because you'll know people who think they don't have time for other people. That is lonely. They're independent. They believe that they can get along without others, and it's just not the way God wants us to be in this world. Fitness. This doesn't have to be you're running a triathlon. This is what are you doing to have self-mastery over your health, right? So what are you doing to have self-mastery over your health? What are you slipping on that you need to correct? Your finances. Are your finances where you are, want them to be? So when that future spouse blows in, you don't have to explain the $10,000 in credit card debt that you bring into your relationship. Are you on a path for getting your finances, self-mastery and finances? Begs the question, do you have to be all there before your spouse met? Are you on the journey? Is finding someone else who's on a journey of their own sexy? Yeah. Faculty, this is work. What are you doing in your career that gets you to a position where you should be? Are you doing what you need to do career-wise? One of the things I've recently come across in working with a number of you guys-ish is that there's There's a Darth Vader of mentors. You don't have a lot of mentors in your career field because you're moving around a lot, right? It's not how it used to be. And so what I challenge you is find a mentor who's older than you, who can help you talk through things, who's been there before you. Even if it's not your career field, take advantage of what you need to be doing in your career field. All right, and the last one, fun. And the reason I bring this one up, what are you doing for fun? Remember I said you're the karaoke singer, get to karaoke? What's your passion? What are you good at? Do you juggle? Let's go. What are you doing for fun? What's your passion? And the reason I bring this up is because, again, when I work with couples and I see them and they've lost their intimacy and they say, oh, we want our intimacy back, I say, what do you do for play? What's your play? Sit in the dark for 2 hours and you don't share. It's not intimate. Fine, it's not a great movie, but it's not enough. So I want you to challenge you on play. What are you doing today that incorporates play? What do you get out of bed in the morning for? That's another question I ask you. What gets you out of bed in the morning? What do you want to do that keeps you going? Okay. All right. Oh, procrastinate on purpose. Rory Vader. It's a little cheesy. But I like those buckets. Okay. So I want to take a few questions because I know we're supposed to wrap in a few minutes. I can spend a whole time answering questions for you guys, but is there something I can answer before we leave today that will help you feel like, oh, okay, that's why I came?
Let's do four questions.
Four? We don't have any yet. There's a Darth Vader of questions right now.
Right behind you, see?
What? Oh, Vader! Oh, any more embarrassing stories about why I shouldn't have had the DJ there? Okay, yes. Selfishness, for sure, is the number one reason marriages fail. And you guys fundamentally understand that. Because it's a turning away from your partner. If you've had friends who have been divorced, at some point they decided to be selfish instead of turning toward. That's so vague, though. That's just—it's a hard thing because we are all selfish. We have to keep continually reminding ourselves and asking God to help us overcome selfishness. Okay. Any other questions? the number one thing I'd say that successful marriages do, I just gave a talk to the St. Thomas Mothers Association. So these are people who have kids who are under kindergarten age. So a lot of young marrieds. And so I gave them a top 10 list of what you need to be doing in your marriage. And the one I think is very important is micro moments. Marriage is based on micro moments. What that means is there are so many times throughout the day where your partner turns to you and you get a choice to turn to them or to turn away. And this is a John Gottman thing. He talks about how he was reading a mystery novel. He had 6 pages left, and he was just about to identify the killer. And his wife walks in front of him, and he kind of looks up and notices that her face is really sad. And he thinks, she would understand if I finished this with her so I can act like I didn't see her. And he said, that's a micro moment. And he said, I closed it, and I went over to her, and I said, oh, by the way, don't ask that. Ask anything I can do to make your life better. Don't ask what's wrong. What is wrong? What's wrong with you? Okay. So, anything I can do that makes your life better? No? Okay, thank you. But love is micro moments. Love is micro moments. And we choose to turn toward or choose to turn away. And it is in choosing more often to turn toward. And I'm not saying everyone. We found that happily married men turned toward 67%. Not that much. But guess what? You're driving down the highway, and she says, oh, that's funny. That billboard was really cute. That's a turn away. She chatters, blah, 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 blah. And all you have to do is go, that's it. That's a turn toward. That's a turn toward. It's, the milk is low. She's not asking you to get more milk. She just wants you to go, But that's a turn toward. There we go.
On that, I think nothing illustrates better than the It's Not About the Nail video. How do you counsel couples? Because that shows the two basic defaults for most men and women in a relationship. Don't seem to watch it.
Watch it. It's Not About the Nail. It's so well produced.
And how do you counsel them to get past, for a guy, his natural reaction to fix things? First thing, and for a woman to want them to listen and not want them to listen. I mean, how do you counsel?
Super easy. One, I do about there. That's how we work it in my marriage. But here's the thing that we don't ever do as a guy. I'm not saying guys don't, women don't do it either. But as a guy, you want to fix it. You got your toolbox. So she comes home and she's like, my coworker was so mean to me. This happened. And you're like, well, you need to go back in there tomorrow and do this. I got the answers. Just listen to me. Ask. Do you like my advice? And she'll say, nope. And then you say, okay. Tell me. So ask that question. Do you want my advice? You want to know how I deal with it? Ask it. We don't ask. We never ask. Would you like my advice? We never ask that. We should. But recognize your natural tendency. If she knows it, that you want to fix it, that's what I do. I lead with it. Don't fix. Just listen. Just bitch. That's why we call our girlfriends. They understand it. They don't try to fix it. So that's why you don't come to us. And we need you to tell us about those frustrating things in your lives, even though you can't fix it, and even though you don't want to. So that's a turn toward. Because that's how I came up with anything I can do to make your life better. Because I see my husband with grumpy face, and I've said, what's wrong? Nothing's wrong. And I know it's not because.
don't ask your husband what's wrong. Mm-hmm. Ask him, what can I do? Mm-hmm. How do you build that self-awareness in a communication pattern? I think some people here are probably in their 20s and some are in their 30s. Because you have later on in life, it's so hard to break those pathways, right? What are things you could practically do to sort of break those pathways? Just, yeah.
So how do you break your natural tendencies?
Your natural communication.
Your natural communication tendencies.
I mean, I've been in a relationship now for 8 months, and 90% of the fighting, which doesn't happen very often, is just what you say,
yes,
and then how you say it.
Have we not talked about this? Have you ever fought over, you said you didn't want to go to the party. Not say I didn't want to go to the party. I said I would prefer to stay home, and you fight over whether you said not to go to the party. So what I say, because what your question is actually, I think it's an easier answer with the question you didn't ask, which is what happens when a couple gets into a communication pattern? How do you break that? That one's hard, and that's what we try and not have happen before it happens. But it oftentimes is helpful for you to lay out, because these are Groundhog Day issues. You get in the same fight again and again and again, even if the topic is different. So did I date myself with that movie too, by the way? If I were working with you, I'd have you guys write down the triggers that get you there. And then Groundhog Day issues are not important. But what is important is what's underlying them, which is usually a lack of respect or a lack of recognition, and then you have to talk about that. This is a bigger topic to talk about, but how you solve a conflict like that is you gotta break what you do that triggers you and do something completely different. All right, well, thank you guys. I know that ran long, but thank you for
it up again for Ann. And we'll be back in a couple weeks on a topic called when to break up. So
it won't be as crowded in here.
It will not. It will not. So real quick, Brandon Barker, the Director of Evangelization and Discipleship here at St. Thomas Aquinas, and well, this is amazing. The series has gone really well. It's connected, and we still got a couple of great talks coming up in a couple of weeks. I'll get to that in just a second. Just a few things. Personally, my wife, we've been married for 8 years, have 4 kids, and just some of the stuff, going through this relationship series myself, it's been like super helpful, right? Because it's in that constant process of how can I be better? How can we, be the couple that God intended us to be? Why did he put us in one another's lives? It wasn't just to like get by, right? But have a life-giving marriage that is truly drawing both of us, me and my wife and our children, towards heaven, right? I mean, like, that's ultimately, like, at the end of the day, why did God call me to the married life? Well, it's to become a saint. Why did he put my life, or my wife in my life, and not somebody else? Because that was the person that God had for me, likewise. The same person my wife had, or God had for my wife. And it truly is the most amazing thing I've ever done in my entire life, but it's also the most challenging thing I've ever done. And I think, just some of the things that Ann talked about tonight, did that connect with some of you guys? Was that helpful? Yes. And it was helpful for me, so thank you. I want to read just a couple things real quick. Proverbs 31:10 says, "An excellent wife who can find. She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life." I think one that really stuck out with me as I was just kind of thinking through this is 2 Corinthians 6. It talks about, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness?" That for me, right, when I connect with my wife, because I've been in several relationships, some that lasted days, some that lasted years, You know, one was 3 years, extremely unhealthy relationship. And I mean, through that whole time, there was this uncertainty, right? I was the age, I'm like going, like, why is it not happening? Well, part of it is because it was a very unhealthy relationship. So my mind and my thoughts were clouded by mortal sin, just to be blunt. And so I was not able to really see the relationship for what it was. And so I was always second-guessing myself because, right, the light of Christ wasn't being allowed to shine on what was going on. And so, like, I knew that, and so I was afraid, well, but what if it is, what if it's not? And so that kind of kept me just kind of in that stage. Well, the relationship ended, and God put my wife in my life not too long after that. And, you know, it was one of those, had people done what happened with me and my wife, I would have made fun of them. We met, and 4.5 months later, we got engaged, and then we were married like 10 months from the time we met. And at that point in time, it didn't seem like crazy. It doesn't always happen that way, right? Some people date for years and years and years. Sometimes it happens really quick. But at the same point in time, for me, right, those foundational things were there and present. And one of them, and it was the main thing, was our faith, right? I mean, we were on a journey. We hadn't arrived. We weren't there. But that was something between me and my wife, who were both not Catholic at that point in time. But we prayed together. And that's, you know, the question that was asked, like, what's the common thing that keeps marriages together? I was listening to something by Matthew Kelly. It's been probably a year ago. And he was talking about statistically, right? So half of all marriages end in divorce, right? It's higher than that. But what would you guess for marriages that the couple prays together at least once a week, right? The husband and wife, they pray together once a week. What's the divorce rate for a couple that does that? What'd you guess? 1 in every 2,000. Think about that. So that's what, like, I tell my friends, hey, right, if there's one very specific thing that you can do, if you want to, like, boost your chances up statistically, honestly, right, I mean, from 1 out of every 2 to 1 out of every 2,000, like, that's a pretty big deal. Right, and so from a foundational standpoint, right, prayer, that's vulnerability. That's something that's very private, right, very personal. And we're allowing, like, that sort of intimacy in that way, and starting from that standpoint, that really opens up ourselves to truly enter into that relationship and in a way that God established that covenant. And for the purpose, right, to become saints, for us to truly realize ourselves fully with Him. So I just want to plant that seed, because that's really important. So if you're not praying with your boyfriend or girlfriend, if you're not doing that with your spouse, for those married ones of us in the thing, that's something, man, I mean, and it sometimes is awkward and uncomfortable at first, but it's one of those, like, you do it, and what it does together, man, I mean, it is, I mean, it's powerful. Me and my wife, I mean, we pray almost every single day, and it's, our marriage isn't perfect, but that is kind of been the bedrock, our faith in that. Let us stand, let's close with a word of prayer, and let's leave from here and go be the church. Last thing before we enter in prayer, as I was saying a second ago, right, we come like we do at Mass. We come, we receive, we connect with our Lord, we connect with the community to be sent out to go be the light of Christ, to be the hands and the feet of our Lord, to be that smile, that joy, that just that friend, whatever that is. So whether we're at Trinity Hall afterwards, or whether we go home to a roommate, or we're at work, or we're at the grocery store tomorrow, wherever we are, right, we come and experience the love of Christ through one another in this community to go share that with others, right? So again, this is a means to something so much greater. So that's like my challenge to myself and each one of us each and every week, is to leave, to go be the hands and feet, and to be the light of Christ wherever we go. Cool? All right. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Jesus, we love you, and we thank you for this community. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for the gifts that you have given each one of us. We thank you for Anne and her just being available to communicate truth and to challenge us and to just open up our just minds to maybe a different way of thinking, or just as a reminder to what we can do to truly draw us closer to you through serving another person. And so I pray for vocations, for just as people are discerning whether you are calling them to the religious life or to marriage life or to a priestly vocation, and that you would help give each one of us clarity, that for the sins that we are struggling with that are keeping us in a state of darkness and not able to see our lives and our relationships and our own situations, Lord, we ask in Jesus' name that you, through the grace that you have given us in him, help us to remove those sins from our lives, that you would help us support one another in that, and for us to see what it is and to have the courage to do what we know you're asking us to do. I pray for marriages and just the protection of them. I pray for those that are dating to keep them chaste, to keep them holy, and to just provide encouragement that it is truly possible with you. I pray that you would just continue to use this community to communicate your love to others. I pray for the 635. I pray for just what you're doing, and ask that the Spirit would continue to guide. Lord, we ask for Mary again to watch over us always and to keep us focused on you. And so we join our prayers with her, and we pray, Hail Mary.
Full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
St. Thomas Aquinas,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, y'all have a great week. We'll see you at 6:35.